ICAM system. And it would take a whole lot of Texas drugs and Hollywood explosives to make an ICAM system exciting. So, what I'm going to try to do is put some exciting pictures up here. So, as y'all know, down south, we like our NASCAR, we like our college football. Get you really excited about this stuff as we jump in and we'll start talking about ICAM. So, in a previous life, I was a driver program. So when I joined the auto trader group at Cox Automotive, my initial trainer was very knowledgeable. He had been through a bit of training. He had architected our environment. He had actually installed it in a bunch of production and our labs. He upgraded me from ManageIQ up to Cox 2.0. And then after working with him for a couple of months, he up and quit. He said, they need to use this car and they need to replace it. So my trainer left. Him over there, Brad Asgard. So, even with Brad's untimely departure, we had goals. We wanted to push button automation, and we wanted to push the infrastructure of the service in order to use our head and use it to go and solve the problem. So, how many people have actually created an automation workflow? So, let me give you my impression of how it is to walk through an automation workflow using the service catalog and platform. These are JD's impressions, so your mileage may vary. What I found is platforms is highly configurable, extensible, it's really flexible and powerful. It is not intuitive. It is, I found that the help files are not. Forums are much, much better now, but when I was doing this a year and a half ago, the actual content was extremely lacking. So there was no one source to find out information. Simple things how to add a tag or something like that. In my Java world, I used to be able to take a code and I could put it in, I could break point in, I could step through the code and actually inspect the object and see what was in the code while I was stepping through and processing it. Platforms that I have that capability. So what I have done is actually take the code from debug statements and then turn it out to a logical because the logical scene that actually happens. So then I must admit for most of everything that I know was kind of self-taught. So I learned this by reverse engineering some of the workflows that I was doing in my lab. And this is just a short list of some of the things that I had to do, actually, to get a workflow up and running. Your mileage may vary. There's different things that you have to do. I've tried to capture everything that I needed to do so I could create a repeatable process. And after going through some of these things, I put it into a flowchart. I tried to get it up to a point where my management could really understand how powerful platforms actually is and everything that's going on in platforms. This is what I came up with. That's pretty descriptive of everything that's going on in cloud forms at one point in time. Trying to look at the logs, EDM logs, and see what's going on. There's a lot of stuff going on. So trying to extract that and get just through automation code, there's a challenge there. So, but I'm actually here to talk about just the last bullet, which is creating an ICAM and using the ICAM. Everything that I'm going to be doing today is based on cloud forms 3.0. We do have 3.1 in the lab. But for my example, I'm going to get into production with 3.0. So that's what I'm going to show you today. So what is my IPAM? Basically, it's a protocol address management system. And basically, what the computer is doing is getting any information you need to be able to put it out on the network. So IP, hostname, gateway, everything that you need to do that. Obviously, these aren't real security measures that I'm putting out to the lab. Just gives you a good general idea. So basically what it is within cloud forms, this is the IPAM database is something that you would think of as an actual class and each individual to and address to. And basically, if those people are populated, then you're going to set them up within the industry. If those are not populated, then you also have this one right here. You can tell that this is in use. There's an in use flag called true. And when that happens, it also sets the date acquired and the reserve token. You can look over at the left tree and see if you see IP dash company. You know that IP has been taken. If it's empty, then you can set a quick visual reference. A bit of an eye chart, but I took this is an estate machine. It's developer related, not my collection. So I have a single estate machine that I use for every single thing in the workflow. So we use the skills to take up the experience. It's actually made me pull that off. Actually, that's the best thing about extracting the domain. I said, developers are lazy. Part of my lazy manifesto, I've taken out all the things that were unique to a workflow and moved them into the customized request method. And that way I could get all that information that was unique to that workflow in one place, and then I had the methods for both provisioning and retiring. But in this one right here, if you're using a static IP address, you call this method. Right there, we call it, and we use a tag, and that's provisioning, and we take the name that they've always created and put it into the process so far, and the name, and then they'll take that.